He's going, oh, he doesn't know why. Because it's part of his character that's come in his psyche, if you like, from previous life. So it gives an explanation of why you might have phobias. It also gives an explanation of why you might have child geniuses. If you ask a person, this Professor Penrose, you know, my mentor, under whom I did my PhD, my master's in theoretical physics, was a child genius. He could solve equations at a very young age, very clever. Where did he acquire it from? You ask, well, genetic mutation, just random mutation produced this genius. No. In many previous lives, this guy was focusing on maths. And then it becomes visible in this life like that. From a very early age, child prodigies, reincarnation gives a deeper insight. So there are many issues that come up with reincarnation that have relevance in modern times. Cognitive sciences, phobias, geniuses can be, I'm just simply suggesting, can be better explained through the theory of reincarnation. This is my proposal. You don't have to swallow it. I'm just telling you. Take one more question.
Sorry.
Yes, yes, madam.
Do you have to be born a Hindu to be a Hindu?
Big problem. You see, first of all, let me tell you, these brown-skinned people make no claim of being any special. We don't have any monopoly on spirituality. We are not the chosen people in any sense. We make no such claims. In fact, we are saying spirituality is not confined to us. Other religions have their own version of it. And good luck to everybody. We mean it. It's not a patronizing comment. So there's nothing special about us. So why do you want to join us? If a Christian comes and says, Jay, I want to become Hindu, I say, no, no, you're fine as you are. Pluralism, pluralism. Stick to your own pathway because it relates to your starting point, your culture, your background. It relates to your own background. Focus on that and progress spiritually using the pathway that suits you, that fits with your background, with your starting point. Don't change. Don't you dare come in and say, don't become a Hindu. You're fine as a Christian. And when you become a Hindu, you become a problem for us. Stay where you are. I'm sorry. Stay where you are. You are better off. So we discourage. You see, if I'm a genuine pluralist, I can never encourage people to convert to my tradition because that means I'm not a pluralist. I'm saying we are better. We are not better. In fact, as I just showed you, we are very poor. Bollywood is our religion now. We are struggling, so why do you want to join that? You are fine as you are. So we do not, in any sense, invite conversions. We don't like to be converted, and we don't like to convert others. Let me do a funny story. You'll enjoy this. There's a lecturer in London who kept bothering me, a Christian, kept bothering me. Said, Jay, I want to become a Hindu. I said, no. I'm a genuine pluralist. Not just making sure. I mean business here. I will not let you become Hindu. He said, why not? You are chosen. I said, no, we are not chosen. You are fine as you are. Become a good Christian. Carry on. You're doing a marvelous job. No, I want to become Hindu. He kept fighting me. I had a big problem with him. And I would not agree. He said, why are you stopping me? I said, no, but this is pluralism. We don't want to change, want you to change. Then he finally said, Jay, do you believe in reincarnation? I said, sure, to be a Hindu, you need to believe in reincarnation. You are stuck with it. He said, oh, in that case, let me tell you, in my last life, I was a Hindu. In this life, I overshot my destination. I was born in the neighbor's house, and this is my problem. So I want to get back to it. Look, now you see, when you take me on at this level, and I say you win. I'm telling you a real story. So we are not saying we are special people. We do not encourage people to embrace our pathway. We say hang on to your own pathway, progress towards your destiny. Let me do a nice final story. Because Krishna was supposed to explain to you the practical part. This is the theory and high-flying stuff. Krishna was supposed to do the second session and do the bread and butter stuff for you. Otherwise, you'll be in trouble in school. You can't talk all this stuff there. Let me finalize with some lovely metaphor. You see, pluralism appears like anything goes. It's not that. Because you might think this means flower power and all this going back to nature. We are not saying that. We are not encouraging any of that. We are very, very, you know, rigorous system of thought. Let me give a final metaphor you will like. Suppose I want to come out of the door and I point in the direction and I say I have to turn, go north by northeast and take 20 steps to come out. If each and every one of you pointed to the door and decided what prescription applies to you, and then you compare your prescription with your neighbor, person sitting next to you, you say, oh dear, he's got a different direction than mine. Each and every one of you will appear to have a different prescription to reach the door. And you might come to a conclusion that, oh dear, there is no reason or rhyme. Everybody has a different prescription. That means anything goes. You know, this is the weird thing about pluralism. You must make sure it doesn't become that. Pluralism doesn't mean anything goes. Doesn't say anything of the sort. It says the prescription that applies to you is binding. So what applies to me is binding. Suppose I follow his prescription, I'll hit the wall. And the same with him. He can't follow my prescription. He has to follow his own prescription. It's binding for him. So anything goes is not the resolution. The prescription which suits your own starting point is binding for you. You cannot run away from it. So if you are born as a Christian, you culturally, historically, you know, in every sense, you have a Christian tradition from which you sprang out. Then you have a binding prescription already. Follow your prescription to its conclusion. Go there. Don't go shopping for religion. Don't be a Hindu in the morning, Buddhist in the afternoon, and Sufi in the evening. Don't do stuff like that. The prescription you have got is a tried and tested pathway for spiritual progress. Progress to your destination. Don't fight over prescriptions. We all have different prescriptions. Don't fight over prescription. Proceed to the destination. You know what's the wonderful thing about this metaphor? If I'm a genuine Hindu, proceeding to my destination, he's a practicing devout Christian following his prescription. The more closer we get to our destination, the more sincere we are in our own prescription. As we get closer and closer to the door, we feel tremendous affinity for each other. You don't feel frightened by each other. Without knowing why, we relate to each other. We feel affinity. We have this difference. He's a Christian, I'm a Hindu. And yet I feel tremendous oneness with him. Why? Because we are making progress to the destination. If I'm not making progress, I'm going backwards. I will have a problem with him, I will have a problem with my own. So the final kind of lovely metaphor of pluralism is, it reflects your own starting point. Proceed to the destination rather than fight over the prescription. Progress to the destination. The aim is to hit the destination, not fight about the prescription. If you are a good Muslim, be a better Muslim. Good Hindu, become a better Hindu. You see, we have different worldviews. Two life scenario, many life scenario, only one life scenario. Progress to the conclusion of your own particular view and you'll feel tremendous affinity with people of other faith without any compromise. This is something to test out. My experience in the field, I have tremendous affinity with Christians, with Muslims, tremendous affinity. I have no difficulty as long as they are sincere in following their own prescription. This is the, if you like, the final glory of the idea of pluralism. Proceed using your own prescription. With that, I think I'll finish. Thank you very much, my friends.